Hey, Grio fam, it's Natasha. We are live from our studio here in New York City. This week on The Grio, we brought you an episode of Grio True Story, which focused on a man who was starting his life over after getting a 30-year prison sentence related to drug charges. That man received a commutation from President Barack Obama after applying, and now he's getting a chance to start his life over again. And we have him in studio with us today. This is Eric Alvarez. Welcome to the show. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you again after spending some time together and sharing your story. So many people reacted positively to seeing your story, but also with a lot of shock at, you know, your experience in the criminal justice system. How do you feel just being out right now? What do you think is just your state of mind, you know, having, it's been a few months now, you know, since you got a chance to come home. What's been your state of mind?
Just I'm happy. You know, to be happy, I mean, like, if I'm having a bad day, I'm too happy to recognize it. I can't tell that I'm having a bad day. Because people don't understand when your freedom is taken or when you got certain things taken from you and then it's given back to you as a chance, when you know that you didn't have to get that chance, that feeling is something that I can't even describe. It's really amazing. I walk down the street, and I'm like, hey, hi, good morning, good afternoon. I mean, like, people, get away from me. You know, New Yorkers are like, okay, don't talk to me, you know, but I'm just happy. And they just don't understand the happiness that I have in my soul, in my spirit.
Yeah. I think that it's easy to take certain things for granted, like you said, taking freedom for granted. What do you think was the hardest part about being behind bars? I know that there's so many different elements, but the thing that kind of maybe still sticks with you today.
Is, you know, trying to be with family. Like, so many things took place in the 17 years that I was gone. Not all bad. You know, some of them partied. Some of them got together, hung out, went on cruises, went on trips. Some, you know, building memories. And I wasn't a part of that. You know, and then even the tough times when you lose a family member or something drastic happens in the family, just to be able to hold somebody and just say, look, we're going to get through this together. You know, I had to suffer through that, a lot of that stuff in jail by myself and with my extended family, because there was a couple brothers in there that actually became part of your family. They became part of your inner circle. You felt their pain, they felt your pain, because I wasn't the only one that actually went through this. I know a lot of guys that was in prison that wish they could be with their family on their mother's 70th or 50th anniversary or when somebody passed away, or you know, just different situations that happen in life.
Yeah, and so you said that you kind of have to rebuild a new family in a way, a new support system.
Well, in prison, you build a new support system because you become close to a lot of the guys that are in there that are doing the time and going through the same things that you go through. You know, and then, you know, it might be a basketball team. You might be on a basketball team and it's the group of y'all against everybody else. And then in the units, you might have a group of guys that y'all cook with, and we cook every weekend, you know, or a softball team, soccer team, you know, it varies, the people that you work with. So you got your little groups, and then you might spend 5, 6, 7 years. I spent 7 years in one prison. So 7 years, you even become, and you're not supposed to do this, you become close to some of the guards. Some of the guards don't even call you Mr. Alvarez. They start calling you by your nickname. And, you know, that's how close it comes, because you see these people every day, day in and day out. And you don't know, you know people better when you live with them. Mm-hmm. And we're living with, you know, with these people day in and day out for years.
Yeah. I kind of want to rewind back to the thing that led to you going to prison. So, you know, drug charges, we talked a lot about the war on drugs, and people talk about the inequality and the fact that a lot of Black and Latino people were targeted or profiled when it came to drug charges and being arrested for those things. To the people who don't understand what would be the draw for getting involved in drugs, talk a little bit about that, because you grew up in a two-parent family home. You know, you have great family. I met your family. It's not the sort of stereotype that people would think for somebody who ends up in that game. So what were the challenges and kind of the draws of that lifestyle?
You know, I live in a neighborhood where I was growing up, I walked right outside and seen drug dealers sell drugs. It wasn't violent. every now and then you might see somebody get shot, beat up, or something like that. But in my neighborhood, that was almost like typical. That was not nothing like, oh, so drastic. So when you see the lifestyle that they lead, when they pull up in the pretty cars, they always dress them pretty. They get all, you know, the guys that hustle, because you barely see women hustle. Mm-hmm. But you see the guys, and then all the girls, all the bad girls, all the chicks come around and they want to get with these guys. You get caught up in a limelight that's like, oh, when I grow up, I want to be like them. Because you don't see guys in my neighborhood that actually go to college and get the BMWs and the Mercedes and all this other stuff. You see the drug dealers get that. So when you're growing up, I'm looking at it like I never went without food in my house, electricity. You know, I've had all the toys. I've had everything growing up because my mother and father was real supportive. But when you're seeing what them people are doing on the corner, I mean, I'm coming out with a basketball to go to the basketball court, and I see junkies. I see, you know, all this stuff going taking place in front of me. This is my school, the streets. So even growing up, I got out of high school, yeah, my intentions was to do right, but you always have this in your face. Mm-hmm. And when you have it in your face, the opportunity comes, you realize how easy it is, and you jump right in it.
One thing we didn't really go into with the story was the fact that you said you had started to move away from the drug game. You were running a club, you were DJing, but at that point, it was kind of too late, and that's when your case took off. Tell me a little bit about dealing with the court system. What made you turn yourself in, and then, you know, what did you think you were up against, and then what really happened?
Okay, let me just clear one thing up. I didn't turn myself in.
Mm-hmm.
I had intentions on turning myself in because as my life was going on, it was really getting to the point where it was out of control. A lot of people don't understand that selling drugs is stressful. You know, I mean, everybody sees the glory, but you don't understand that you got to be worried about the police, the feds, the stick-up guys, the connect that might have some bad work or whatever the case may be. You know, so you're dealing with a lot. You're dealing with strictly cash. You know, that draws a lot of negative things because people might look at you and get jealous. You know, there's stories uptown where kids get kidnapped because people think that you got so much money. And then they want to come and kidnap your kid or your wife or your brother or your mother just to try to get some of that money. So these are the things that you really got to be careful about.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, I didn't turn myself, when I actually got out the game, it was because with my life being so out of control, I wanted to put it back in a proper perspective. I had a lot of issues going on with me and my girl at the time. You know, me not being in my son's life, me not being in my daughter's life. You know, so it was a lot of issues going on, you know, and then I knew I wasn't healthy. I was 260 pounds, you know, eating every fast food there was. They knew me by name when I walked in the fast food place.
Mm-hmm.
So it came to a point where I just really needed to sit down and get my life back in order, but it was too late. The damage was done. And the feds, conspiracy, you don't have to get caught with nothing.
Right.
9 months later, here I am after working and trying to get my life back in order, coming home every night. Then I get indicted. I get indicted because people around me were still participating in certain things, and when they was getting caught or when they was getting caught up, my name was being said a lot. So when it was time for me, when I found out I got indicted and they was looking for me, I was gonna turn myself in. But then I sat back and I thought about it and I was like, you know what? I was so mad that here I am trying to change my life and now they trying to come get me after the fact.
Mm-hmm.
So I took off.
So it was a period of 2 years, and then eventually things came around.
Yeah, they caught me.
Right, right.
They caught me on, I was in Florida under that alias working, matter of fact, I was doing drywall.
Mm-hmm.
I had a little company. I had a company subcontracting me all the drywall,
mm-hmm.
and I was living, but I called home. I missed home, and they was tapping the phone still.
And they found you.
And they found me.
Yeah. So one of the things that really stood out in the story was your family and how supportive they were, but also just how devastating this was for them to lose their brother and their son. We're actually going to show a clip of your parents who we met in Harlem talking a little bit about the experience of you being sentenced, but also that day that they found out that things were turning around and you were coming home. So let's watch the clip.
And as soon as he picked up the phone, I said, either you're coming home or they reset your minutes a lot earlier. He says, I'm coming home. And then at that point, I couldn't speak anymore.
We have always been thinking about moving to Florida, you know, we're buying a house down here. But I told Ann, I said, I'll never leave New York as long as he's in prison. You know, as long as he's up here in the New York State going from one prison to another, we're going to stay here.
What did it mean to have your family be so supportive of you over that 17-year sentence? I mean, your parents get emotional talking about you and the fact that you were going to come back. What did it mean to have them there?
You know, I met a lot of people when I was incarcerated who didn't have family, who did have family and lost like their mother and father. That was one of my biggest fears, actually, being incarcerated. You know, I lost my son while I was incarcerated, and that was really hard. You know, you got your sister, you got your brother, you know, you got your nephew, your nieces, your aunts, your cousins. I lost a cousin who was really supportive of me while I was incarcerated. He got murdered. I got another cousin. As a matter of fact, I got another cousin that passed away that I don't know what actually took place, but, you know, she passed away. They found that at the house, she wasn't breathing, and she passed away. So to have my mother and father come constantly over the 17 years, you know, and I seen them get old in the visiting hall. Like, you know, one day they young and then now they bent over walking slow, now they taking their time. And, you know, it was a blessing just to not only have them support me the years that I've been down, but to still be here. Because now I'm so grateful, like, I try to do everything for my mother and father. I feel like a kid, like, I do all the chores around the house. You know, like, I try to empty out the trash, I try to wash the dishes, if my mother needs help, I'm going to do it right now, don't worry, sit down, you know, because they've been there for me. And I want to make sure that until they in the ground, that I want to be there for them. Because my sister and my brother have been there for them while I wasn't there. Mm-hmm. So now it's almost like it's my turn to step up and take care of my mother and father and whoever else in the family. Because I got aunts that I'm trying to go see and, you know, just let them know that I'm here. Mm-hmm. You know, because not only just my mother and father, my sister was supportive. You know, I got aunts, I got a few cousins. You know, my brother, I got some friends that was real supportive. You know, so I can't not include them in this equation. Because there was times when my mother and father probably couldn't come see me and I would get a surprise visit from a friend or another family member. Or I might get a letter. Christmas, I used to get so many cards, you know, and I used to make it my business to write everybody, even the people that didn't write me. Because I was letting them know, I don't look for you to write me so I could write you. I'm trying to let them know that, look, I'm writing you because you're family regardless or you're my friend regardless. Even though you caught up in your whatever you're going on out there.
That's real friendship.
Oh, yeah, you know. And then at the end of the day, you know, you got to lead by example. You can't, you know, I never wanted to let somebody say, I come home and I look at you and I say, why you didn't write me? And then they turn around and say, well, why you didn't write me? Goes two ways. Since I've been home, I got people's numbers. They say, yo, call me. I say, call me too. It goes both ways.
Yeah. One of the questions that we asked in this story was, what makes the difference between somebody who goes back and someone who stays out? And it's clear that you have will. I mean, just listening to you talk, you're passionate and you are determined to succeed. But a lot of the brothers that you spent time with behind bars, the statistics show that recidivism is high when they come out. So many end up back in within just a few years. What is the difference what is the difference between those who stay out and then those who end up going back? What makes that difference?
You just got to change your way of thinking. My way of thinking is that I will never put myself in a predicament that's going to jeopardize me going back to jail. Yeah, it's easy for me to say that because I have a supporting cast. I have the family and the friends who's actually been there for me since I've been home that's helping me get back into society. I mean, I got a job, I'm driving, I got a car, you know, I got a place to stay. But you got some people who come home and don't have that, for whatever the reason may be. And when you actually, when these guys go out there and actually try to get a job and submit applications and constantly getting turned down and don't have no money in their pocket, and you start seeing, you in your own neighborhood and you see these guys hustling, you'd be like, man, I don't really want to do this. But at what point do I keep getting rejected and not get a job when I know I'm trying? I'm living with a girl who don't want me there, constantly telling me you can pack your stuff and get out. You know, I know one brother that actually had to deal with that kind of abuse because he didn't really have nowhere to go. And the girl threatened him almost every day to say, you can get out of my house.
Yeah.
It makes it hard. You know, it's still no excuse. You got to have a change of mind. You got to have a will that says that no matter what comes in my way, that I gotta make it, because jail is not cool. Not 17 years, at least. I mean, not even a day. A day in jail, so much can happen in a day. I got released in one day. I got 30 years in one day. I lost my son in one day. I got notified that I was getting clemency in one day. One day makes a big difference. So people got to understand that if you want to spend time in jail, then you know what you got to do to go out there and get back in jail. But it ain't easy. It ain't easy out here. You know, I have a job. It's paying me good, but it's not enough for me to afford an apartment on my own. Rent around New York City is sky high. And I even talk to brothers that's in other states. You know, the income that I can make here is almost equivalent to what they can make there and what the housing is there. I want my own place. It would be nice. I'm not asking you to help me completely. I'm just asking you to give me a helping hand. Mm-hmm. And that's not asking for a lot.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people are commenting here saying that, you know, it's the truth that you're speaking, but most of all, they notice your humility. You know, because I imagine it's hard. You're a 50-year-old man now, and you lived the fast life. You
Wait
work.
A minute, I'm not 50.
Wait, how old are you?
I'm 50.
See? I did my research.
I don't look 50. I'm 20. I just turned 21. I just turned 21. My birthday just passed. No, I'm 50.
But yeah, you know, thinking about that, there's a humility in, like you said, living with your parents and working and knowing that you can make more in other places. And I imagine that that's challenging. And like you said, that's part of the reason some people go back, because it's like they can't deal with that reality. We have a comment here. This is from Denton. And Denton wrote that even when we act right, why do we expect to move forward when at any given time we can stand on a space that says take 10 steps back or go back to start? So basically, every time you try to move forward, you know, it feels like things are taken away from you. This is from Trice. Trice says, just because someone sells drugs doesn't mean they're horrible or bad people, but the system only thinks white people can be good people and sold drugs. I actually want to ask you about that injustice question, because, you know, did you ever get angry thinking about the fact that you got a 30-year prison sentence when you know that there are people who sold cocaine and who maybe got less time?
You know, maybe when I first came into the system, I had that outlook. But I can't be mad at nobody for what I put myself into. See, the biggest problem that we have as youth, like even myself, I played the game and didn't even know the rules. If I would have known at least a little bit of the law, the conspiracy, what it takes to get conspiracy, how much time it carries, and all this other stuff, then I probably would have had a different outlook on maybe the drug that I would have pushed. And that's just saying that if you're going to play a game, at least know the rules. Being ignorant to the law is no excuse. We can go in there and we can say, oh, you targeted us, I'm black, I'm Spanish, white this and white that. But at the end of the day, you put yourself in that predicament. And you didn't actually do your homework. You know that any time that you walk down the street and you get into something, when you walk in the restaurant, you look at the menu. We get into these games, we start selling drugs, we start doing this and we start doing this, and we don't know nothing about the law, because I didn't. I relied on a lawyer to tell me that I thought I was going to get 15 years And then here I am, I signed a plea agreement on the strength of a lawyer, and then I'm looking at life. How did you do that? It was a thing where when I actually got incarcerated, I had to become a law clerk in order to understand the law and understand how did I wind up with 30 years. Because you can't, at the end of the day, I can't blame the system. I can't blame another skin color, another race. I can't blame nobody for not knowing what I put myself into. Mm-hmm. You got to know at this point what you're dealing with. So when I make a decision now, I take my time to read everything before I sign anything. I signed the plea agreement, and then all of a sudden, here I am, they're trying to give me life. But I signed the paper, and I didn't even have a complete understanding of what I was actually signing.
Right.
So who am I blaming? I'm blaming the lawyer at this point for not knowing, for not taking the time out to actually thoroughly search what I'm signing. Mm-hmm. And it's sad because it's a lot of us like that.
Right, right.
Because we grew up in that lifestyle not knowing to do the homework of knowing the rules of the game.
Well, speaking of the rules of the game, before we finish today, I want to talk about the hope in the story. So when you got the commutation from President Obama, you worked very hard on this for a period of time. You told me that you almost became like a law student because you were studying, you know, the laws, studying the books, and you partnered with the Clemency Project, a lawyer from the Clemency Project. What would you say to President Obama? I mean, I can't imagine getting a letter, like you said, in one day, your whole life changed. What would you say to him if you could say anything?
If you ever need a DJ, come get me. I'll do it for free. Every function that you have, I will do for free. No, in all reality, it's like we never met. Of course, there's a lot of us that would I would just love to shake his hand and tell him thank you. And for the people that are watching, see, there were 1,700 people that was gave clemency to. Soon as one guy does something wrong, everybody wants to focus in on that one guy and don't want to see what the other people are trying or achieving. And it's sad because we're so quick to jump on that one guy that did wrong that we look at everybody else like they should have never got a chance. And that's sad. And I would love to meet Obama, just tell him thank you. I might just kiss him. You know, he might feel some type of way, but I would just hug him and he'll be like, "Yo, let me go." And I was like, "You just don't understand. I had 9.5 years left on my sentence, and he gave me a break that almost 30,000 people wish they could have got and didn't get." Mm-hmm. There's a lot of brothers that deserve breaks, and they just ain't get it. They didn't make the cut. And I'm more than grateful that I made the cut. And it's because of him, the best president on the planet. Yeah.
Well, before we finish today, we actually have a message for you. This comes from your lawyer. His name is Raymond Tarleton.
Yeah, that's my
and
man.
And this is the person who helped you with your application for clemency. And he writes, "Eric, more than a decade ago, you did wrong, but a 30-year federal sentence for what you did was far more wrong. President Obama gave you a second lease on life by giving you clemency. But so many people just as deserving as you will probably never receive such a legal miracle. Don't take that for granted. You are on the right path with hard work and embracing your family. An old saying is if you are doing well, you should be doing good. People have so much to learn from your story. Go out and do some good." And that's from Raymond.
Yeah, that's cool. You know, I've talked to Raymond a bunch of times, and he was the one that actually called me. Well, when they called me in the office, my counselor at the time told me that my lawyer wanted to speak to me. Mm-hmm. So when we got on the phone, he started going through like the process of what it takes to get clemency. And like when he told me on the phone that I had got clemency, I was just no good. I cried like, I mean, I think I had snots all over my nose. I was trying to clean on. And from that day, I just let him know, like, look, thank you, because he didn't have to take the time out to fight for me. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people didn't have to take the time out to come visit me. Mm-hmm. They didn't owe me. They did that willingly. So when you look at these people who actually go in the ring and fight for you, I mean, you got to be thankful. You got to be grateful. And you know, thank God for the blessing for putting them people in your life.
Yeah. Well, we hope that people take away from this story. If you are watching today, we thank you so much for participating and share the word, you know, get the word out there, because there are other people who are still behind bars who have really harsh mandatory minimum sentences that they're still living out, and they need advocates and people to fight with them for justice. Before we leave, we want to give you some books.
Okay.
We want to give you some books and some reading. These are books about encouragement. This is a book written by somebody who was a former crack drug dealer, and he became a professor and a writer. And so our wish to you is that, you know, with this second chance, you really make the best of it, and we know that you will go far. So
yeah, thank
best
you.
Of luck to you.
I
and thank you so
that.
Much, Grio fam, for tuning in. We will catch you next time on the next episode of Grio True Story.
Peace.